So, looking back into today's NXP portfolio, what do we have? We are number one in infotainment chips, car radio chips. 19 of the top 20 car radio makers are using our car radio chips. Of course, as I said, we started from a Philips in heritage AM/FM transistor radios, class AB amplifiers, so that's basically the base level. And then we moved to very energy efficient class D amplifiers and RF CMOS one chips. What that means is we have the tuner and the baseband in CMOS for the first time combined. A lot of our competitors had the tuners in one technology and the baseband in another technology, so you never could merge that into a one chip. Basically what you have now as of today is basically you can take these chips and you can make them even for digital radio reception software programmable. So this software programmability is of course one thing where you have a Korean digital radio standard, a German one, and a Canadian one. Just think of HKMC, they would have to develop three different radios, have to qualify three different radios, and all for a pretty small market, for the German market, for the Korean market, and for the Canadian market. What a nightmare, yeah? Instead of that, they can take one of our chips, say, okay, the hardware is always the same, and I'm changing the software on top of that. I'm just changing the software to the Korean standard, to the German standard, and even while I'm driving, I can change, yeah? So, who cares whether France has a different standard than Germany? When I cross the border, I just know via GPS where I am, I swap. Yeah? So very easy. And that is, of course, one chip receives everything, is the road to go here. The other thing is the car keys, as I mentioned prior. We started 20 years ago with immobilizers for cars. And these immobilizers are nothing else than little crypto chips. We moved that into remote keys. From these remote keys, we moved into so-called two-way keys. This is car keys that range over 1 kilometer of distance, 1,000 meter in the open field. So I can sit here and say, okay, the session is over. I press my key and the climate control goes on in my car. I switch my laptop down, go down 10 minutes later, my car is climatized already, I can drive. The same silicon is that silicon that we use also for the smart meter to Wi-Fi plug at home. And what we have is we have passive keyless entry and passive keyless go, as we call it. A chip of the size of my little fingernail that can easily fit into a smartwatch or into a smartphone already, but is in principle a complete key. So I have this key in my pocket. I do not need to operate that key anymore, so press open or close. No, I approach my car. Out of 10 meters of distance, the car recognizes me and says, hello, Lars. So puts the door handles out and switches the welcome light on in my favorite color. So whether it's pink, yellow, green, I have to choose. It's a totally useless use case. But everyone wants to have it. It is hotter than aluminum wheels at cars because you can make your neighbors jealous with it, yeah? So if your car reacts to you like a dog when you come home and your neighbors don't have that, so all the premium car makers are looking into that, and this is one of the fun toys of premium cars in the years to come. The great thing is, of course, that we have this so small, and you can integrate it in all sorts of form factors, like variables, smart things. So this is two of our very strong leadership portfolios. The portfolio that we're going to talk about today then is this one here, and you see here already the Ethernet logo appearing. So NXP is also market leader for these IVN physical layers, for these transceivers, for low data rates, very cheap connections between control units or a switch to a control unit, window lifter, for example, you need LIN. Then you have CAN in tons of flavors. So CAN for normal CAN transceivers, of course, CAN for hybrid vehicles, 48 volts approved, CAN for electric vehicles, up to 1,000 volts for the electric batteries isolated. All that stuff, high data rate, so flexible data rate, partial networking CAN. Now what we have is FlexRay on top of that and Ethernet. So a very, very hot trend in the industry. So basically, how does that in-vehicle networking world look like? The amount of control units in a car is growing like that. So there really you have this interface node count grows as you see it there. Just to give you an example, a Tata Nano has two control units in the entire car. So this is basically the engine management and the car access unit, so the key checking unit. That's everything in electronics in the Tata Nano. The Mercedes S-Class has more than 150 of those units per car. In a self-driving car, of course, you have all these different units like radar elements at each corner of the car, up to 10, 15 cameras per car. Just imagine, one modern car, 5 series BMW, in 3-4 years from now, will have 15 cameras. So, traffic sign detection, lane departure warning, blind spot detection, all of these things, interior monitoring, and they are all getting connected. So each one is a separate node, each one is a separate IBN interface. On average, we have more than 10, on average, more than 10 of those interfaces already today in every car that is built worldwide that come from NXP. So if there would be a big bang and NXP would disappear from this planet, you could not even get the cars off the assembly belt at the end of the car makers. What we usually don't use in public is, of course, also airplanes are using these networks and these transceivers very often, and they are heavily relying on these networks. So of course they are much smaller volume and so on, but big airplanes, passenger airplanes, don't even know whether the doors are closed without our CAN transceivers. We have 6 billion of those nodes in the market, of course not all in airplanes. More than 50 different devices. I just said that that's quite broad. We have 20 years of production, especially in CAN and LIN. And what we are really, really proud of is, but that's of course a figure that has to be very, very carefully watched, we are at the moment far below 1 ppm, parts per million defects in those devices. So this is really what the automotive industry 10 years ago was demanding. We need 0 ppm. We are at the moment at 0.7. This is cool. The only thing is, of course, we need to watch out that not a single incident, not a single manufacturing hiccup or whatsoever can destroy that value proposition. So quality is very, very much on our mind, and also the quality paranoia is there. This is nothing where you can relax on and say, okay, we are there, it's all done. And then, of course, having all of that competence is a great thing, because customers, the car makers, they are coming to our experts. They're putting a complete wiring harness on the table. And wiring harnesses in luxury cars, they are heavier than I am. They contain more than 6-7 kilometers of cable. And they are the second heaviest device in a car. And they put them on the table and say, can you, NXP, please help us in checking whether our wiring harness, our electronics, is robust? So what happens if crazy Lars brings a wireless charge pad and a mobile phone into the car, yeah, and just plugs it into the cigarette lighter? What happens to the airbag system? Is that deploying at 200 kilometers per hour on the motorway? Of course, must not happen. So we are checking the robustness of all of that, yeah? And you can see it here already. What is, of course, the name of the game? The car makers want to have more interfaces in, but want to pay less. So what we do in the electronics is, of course, we try to increase the price of our chips by up-integrating features from around the physical layer. So if you need capacitors, try to up-integrate them. If you need a choke or a coil, try to up-integrate these devices and try to become more efficient there.
So,
but how does that portfolio look like? Well, you see it here. This is I try to sketch a bit these various flavors. Yeah. So of course we are trying to integrate these network nodes with different functionality. Power functionality, all sorts of topics that a new microcontroller would need on an ECU. We call this system basis chips, where we have CAN channels plus LDOs on. And you see here the complete portfolio of that. So two CAN, a switch mode power supply, all of it. Then what we have is, of course, we have the flavors of networking features, as I said prior. So we have chokeless CAN. We are saving the coils. So you don't need these coils anymore, expensive coils on the PCBs. We have partial networking. Partial networking is a communication where you can switch off complete CAN networking channels. So just assume you have a car with a trailer hook. How often do you need that trailer hook? Of course, that does not need to be active all the time. Only if you have a trailer, really, that you are pulling with your car, you want that thing to be, of course, active. But in normal use, I would say 99.9% of your driving time, that does not need to consume energy. So there is sleep modes for these whole branches. then what do you need? 48 volts for hybrid cars. The isolated pen for electric vehicles. And what we have is we have addressable LIN, which is basically a self-learning LIN node for interior lighting, for example. So you have 50 or 70 LEDs inside a car, and it would be a disaster if a car maker would have to have them all in different buckets and say, LED number one, LED number two, LED number three. No, what we do is they are all the same. The manufacturing folks in the plant, they are just putting them onto that cable tree, and then press a button and say, now please learn. You are number one, you are number two, you are number three. And this thing is self-learning with a steering pulse. So the LEDs know where they are in the chain, and they stay programmed. CAN flexible data rate, I said already, this is getting more than 3 megabit over a normal CAN, rather than the 500 kilobit. Ethernet, we are coming to, and then of course there is different research topics also, and how do we enhance security in these networks, how do we do power line communication, and is there also in automotive a way into wireless communication, so wireless in-vehicle networks. At the moment the industry is pretty hesitant on those topics here, because they want to see of course what happens if you have a disturbing radiation, EMC topics, security attacks from the outside, and so on. But in principle, of course, if the whole world goes wireless, why shouldn't automotive it? So basically,